turn it off. Moving forward, I'll ask that we all please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, a couple items, sort of housekeeping. For the board's consideration, there's been a request to have a closed session at the end of this meeting. So I'll ask for that consideration to start things off. At the close of this meeting, there might be a closed executive session as permitted by the General Provisions Article Section 3-305, Subsection B. Closed meetings, item one, potential personnel matter. I have the motion language here. Would someone be willing to make the motion to allow the closed session to occur after tonight's town meeting? Mr. Blanchard, thank you, sir.
All right, make a motion to close the July 5th town meeting at the conclusion for a closed executive session for discussion of a potential personal matter as permitted by the General Provisions Article, Section 3-305B, Item 1, to discuss the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluation of appointees, employees, or officials over whom this public body has jurisdiction, or any other personal matter that affects one or more specific individuals.
Great, thank you. The motion's been made. Is there a second for the motion?
I second.
The motion's been made by Commissioner Blanchard and seconded by Commissioner Sweeney. Is there any further discussion?
Mr. President, would it be possible for me to excuse myself just for a second to make a phone call to my wife just to let her know that I will be running later than usual this evening? I was not planning for a closed session this evening.
Understood. Would you be able to remain for the vote? Could you
absolutely
leave the room after the vote? Is that okay?
Yes.
Great. Okay. Thank you. All right. Any other discussion items, phone calls or others? Hearing none. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Anyone against? Okay. The motion carries 5-0. Great. Thank you very much. There will therefore be a closed executive session at the end of this. So at the close of this meeting, there will be a closed executive session as permitted by the General Provisions Article Section 3-305, Subsection B. Closed meetings, item one, potential personnel matter. Okay. Next item, there's been a request from the mayor to modify the sequence of our agenda items, asking that the report related to the website metrics be moved to agenda item number one. Anybody have any concerns about that being moved to number one?
No.
Okay, very good. All right. Mr. Ritz, if you want to step off the dais, that's fine.
Thank you.
If you're happy to accommodate. Okay. Moving forward from there, our next town meeting will occur on August 1st at 7:30 p.m. here. The Citizens Advisory Committee will meet on July 19th at 7:30 p.m. The Planning Commission will meet on July 25th at 7:30 p.m. And I was advised that the Community Heritage Day folks will have a meeting on the 20th. Okay, so it's been modified, not this week?
No.
Okay,
yes,
all right.
No. Yes, she's out of town.
Oh, very good. Okay, so it will occur on July 20th, and the site will be determined.
It's the American Legion.
Oh, the American Legion. Okay, wow, I'm 0 for 2.
At 7 o'clock.
At 7 o'clock, all right. Thank you, sir. Any other meetings we need to be aware of? No? Okay, let's move forward, please. For approval of the minutes, and we do record that Mr. Ritz has stepped off the floor to take care of a personal call. With the commissioners we do have on site, anybody have any questions, modifications, or concerns related to the minutes from the June 6, 2016 meeting? Okay. Is there a motion to accept the minutes from the June 6, 2016 meeting as presented?
I make a motion to accept the town meeting minutes for June 6, 2016, as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second for the motion?
I'll second.
Thank you. The motion's been made by Commissioner Sweeney and seconded by Commissioner Mellor. Is there any further discussion? Okay. All in favor of accepting the minutes as presented, please say aye.
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 Aye. Anybody against? No. The motion carries 5-0. Very good. With Commissioner Ritz back on the dais. Okay. We now turn to the deputies with the police report.
Good evening.
Good evening, Deputy.
This is the police report for June 2016. This evening I'm being accompanied by my supervisor, Sergeant John Benner, now our supervisor.
Welcome.
Traffic stats for the month. We had traffic stops. There was 41 with 51 violations. Going down to the proactive enforcement, the bike patrols are up and the walking ones, so it's kind of, you know, take some time out of, you know, sitting out and doing traffic stops and all that. So it's kind of balance each other out as far as how many stops you get in and whatnot. Calls for service, thefts, one, we had a fraud, destruction of property, no trespassings, had two disorderly disturbance calls, so it's down from like 8 from the previous month. The arrests, we had a traffic arrest, 4 criminal arrests, a juvenile arrest, 1 warrant, and we have 2 open cases where there's pending charges at this time. So we'll get those closed out as soon as we can. The special assignments and events we had last month, the youth offender program on the 6th, we had roll call in Middletown. Both myself and Deputy Rohr were in in-service training for 4 days, the 14th through the 17th. We had the Heritage Days, which we attended pretty much from 7:30 in the morning to 10:30 at night. And we had the Junior Deputy Academy in Middletown on the 27th of June. Under the comments here, the armed robbery at the Dollar General. The suspect is, at this moment, is not caught, and the investigation is ongoing. I know I've had several people come up to me and say, I heard he was caught. I'm like, no, that's not the case. I haven't heard anything about that. And latest I looked on it, it's still open and being investigated at this time. As you know, we had 2 search warrants we served in town last month, 2 different locations at the same time. There were 2 arrests made for those and those search warrants. We had our second Jim Moxley Memorial Rocket Club on the 26th at Memorial Park. We had approximately 10 kids attend that as far as the Frederick News Post. I imagine everybody saw it on the front page of the News Post on Monday. That was a lot of fun. I'd like to thank Pastor John Talcott for coming out and supporting us once again. He brought the bulk of the kids with him again, which we appreciate his support. The next one is going to be, the next Rocket Club event we're going to have is going to be on July 31st at the Memorial Park. If anybody would like to come, they can notify us on the website, reach us at the our deputy website, or email, I'm sorry. I know some people responded to Facebook last time. I'm not checking a whole lot of Facebook in my free time. So people want to, if the easiest way to get a hold of us to let us know you're coming, if you want to let us know, is to just get a hold of us at our email address at the Emmitsburg deputies email address. I know I spoke or emailed Commissioner Malore last time about the light bulb man we located. She brought that up at the last meeting. Happened to run into him like 4 days later. He was a subcontractor of Potomac Edison. So I had him come out of the house he was at that time just to go down, you know, make contact with the town office to figure out if he needed to like sign in or what kind of something he needed to do to go around town. I think that's it for the town reporters. Is there any questions or anything anybody has at this time? I mean, I'll try to answer whatever I can.
You answered, we were talking about the robbery earlier, and you answered our question.
Okay.
About the Dollar General store robbery. We wondered if the person was caught. But I want to thank you and all the organizations for the Heritage Day that helped with Heritage. I want to thank the police force and all you guys helped with the Heritage Days this year.
Sure. Not a problem.
Anybody else? No. Okay, Deputy, thank you very much for keeping us updated. The Community Day item, personally, the bike ride stuff, that was great. I got a lot of positive feedback from parents about you all both participating and supporting the ride. I mean, it kind of drove that safety message home we were trying mm-hmm. to get with the rodeo.
Okay.
The Rocket Club, definitely going well. I mean, that's one of our best attended activities in town, so thank you for doing that, and that's nice to see. And speaking to the staff at the Exxon, they expressed concerns related to the Dollar General robbery, and I know we had this conversation, but
yes.
Any visibility over there, I think, makes them comfortable, especially near their closing time.
Yes.
They were especially, I would argue, a little bit nervous after that event.
That.
So, and I've seen deputies in there talking, and that's great. So I'm glad you guys followed up on that. In Pembroke Woods, there was a car on a sidewalk, and the person posted it on Facebook as opposed to contacting the deputies directly.
Yes.
And it filtered to me, like yourself, not exactly a Facebook person necessarily,
yes.
a number of days later. And one of the first comments they received was, please contact the deputies. But it appeared to have been a silver Honda Civic of a older vintage. I don't know if there's been any follow-up related to that you're aware of?
No, I did check. I mean, okay. the neighborhood and the surrounding streets there, I didn't locate it, you know, an older model Honda of any kind.
Sure. Okay.
But, I mean, I've been sitting up there still some, you know, based on the whole people coming in the one way up there at Irishtown. So, I mean, I've been in there and I've been kind of doing everything at the same time while I've been up there.
That's appreciated. Between the complaint that I get is between the hours of, what is it, between 9 and 11, a big window.
Okay.
There's a lot of traffic coming in. I didn't quantify that, but and there's a serial trash thrower.
Okay.
And I'm wondering if that's our Honda person. I mean, that's
kind of I'll be on the lookout for
somebody alludes
trash
to
thrower.
That. I think if we can get like a bear camera, you know, motion camera up there, maybe we can get the whole thing.
Okay.
I don't know. But nevertheless, those are some concerns that were expressed to me talking to the HOA president and some other folks in Brookfield and Pembroke Woods. The other item is I want to really go back to the Deputy Rohr riding with us and yourself and the unit. That's much appreciated. And, you know, the feedback I got from the parents and from folks who saw that, they really saw the value of that. So thank you. I appreciate you following up on that. And that's kind of where my comments are. So thank you, sir.
All right.
Anybody else? Great. Okay.
All right. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay. moving forward, we go to the town manager's report.
Good evening.
Good evening.
This is May's town manager's report, so it's a combination of my efforts and Mr. Haller's efforts. For the streets, Frederick County paving sealed numerous blacktop patches throughout town. They finished up their fiscal year of paving. And staff assisted with the dedication, the preparation for the Doughboy, closing on some streets, taking care of the lawn. As far as the water's concerned, our wells are now an average of 2.25 feet below their May 2011 levels, which is very good. And in wastewater, we received about 5.4 inches of precipitation. We currently have a deficit of 2.8 inches, which is not that much. And then as far as we had no spills of untreated sewage in the month of May, we exceeded the plant's design capacity on 6 days in the month of May. For the month of July, trash will remain on Mondays with the exception of this past holiday. And as far as the park's concerned, I know, I don't know if everybody's noticed the new bicycle racks. They were installed in Memorial Park, Silo Hill, and I believe there's two in Community Park. The garden plots are up and running, and the staff was did the maintenance of the pool, so it was up and running. We passed the inspection on the first try, so everything went very smoothly this year. And that's all I have. You have any questions?
Great. Okay. Any questions for town manager? Mr. Blanchard, nothing?
Nope.
No? Okay. Great.
Okay.
Thank you. That's appreciated. Okay. Sorry, guys, about the questions. A little slow
Me
in the draw
too.
Up there. Yeah, right? Okay. We now turn to the town planner's report. Ms. Serpoli, hello. Good evening.
Good evening. Working on some of the same things as the previous month, our GIS system. I've been doing some maps for the website. We now have tried to use it to integrate a mailing list so that we could mail letters to all the people in the community legacy area. And that's kind of an ongoing effort. Some of them got their letters this past week. We did a sort of an informational mailing and then a survey if they thought they might have a project in the next, like, next year to the next 3 years, just to give us some idea of the potential for both dollar amounts and just amount of activity. And I've already gotten some of those back. We've also gotten some back that have the wrong address because of the continuing P.O. box thing in Emmitsburg, so we're working on that. Other than than that, we're just, there's always an increase in permits this time of year because of it's summer and, of course, mowing, unlicensed vehicles, trash, and but it's we're moving along.
Great. Okay. Any questions for the planner?
Nope.
No. Okay. All right. Just one item, and this is my mistake. Town manager, I thought this was the planner. I misread this. Item 10 on the last page of zoning and code enforcement, there's a mention of completed and submitted a bike ways grant application to State Highway Administration. Does that relate to Lincoln Avenue or the bike racks? Or
I believe that's for a feasibility study.
Correct? Yeah. That was, I can't remember the exact name of the program, sure. But it's, as Kathy said, feasibility study. It was geared more to getting from the state line down to Mount St. Mary's, for example, like getting not around town so much, but getting from the state line down to Thurmont or,
okay.
You know, so that we can connect with Frederick County has done a lot from Frederick up to about Thurmont.
Sure.
Anyway, we will find that result in August, I believe.
And the feasibility or what's being investigated is a surface street bike route? Is that what it is? Or
it would be looking at how it would be possible to at least get from, for instance, mm-hmm. Tract Road to Mount St. Mary's.
Okay.
Not necessarily all the little streets within the town.
Okay.
But we figured it was a starting point.
Okay, great.
And we can go from there. So sure.
Okay, that's exciting. That's good. Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Anybody else? No. All right. Great. Thank you. All right. We now move on to commissioner's comments. Commissioner Ritz.
I just wanted to thank Jenny Joy and everyone else on the Community Heritage Planning Commission organization, I forget the actual title, and all the other civic organizations such as the Lions Club for helping to have another successful Community Heritage Day. That's all.
Great. Thank you, sir.
I apologize for not being present for Heritage Day. I was in Myrtle Beach on vacation. But I have to say that the Catoctin Banner did a wonderful job of writing what happened in the day and lots of photographs, and they gave you a lot of space in the paper, so I got to see what happened.
It was like you were there, huh?
Yeah.
Good. Okay, great. Thank you. Commissioner Sweeney?
Yes, I would also like to thank all the town staff and everything because you guys helped me prep for the organization, prep for the Heritage Days, getting the parks all mowed and getting everything moved and bathrooms put in. There's a lot of stuff the town helps with too, helping with fireworks and all that other stuff. So it went pretty good, and I've seen some new people from the town there. Terry was there and her son, and Kathy was there for a little while, and it went pretty good. No rain this year, thank God, mm-hmm. And it was well attended, and it was really, really a good day. So thanks for everybody. Especially Jennifer Joy, she was ahead of everything and kept everybody organized, and it went pretty good. So we have a WASH meeting on all the good points and bad points about, and that will be on the 20th of July, and it'll be at the American Legion at 7 o'clock. Anybody would like to come is welcome to come. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Commissioner Blanchard.
Ditto basically everything was said about the Community Day. Wonderful event. I know my wife enjoyed it, all the different activities going on. I had to work that day, but I was glad I was able to combine the evening, participate in the program. One of the other activities occurred during the month of June was Flag Day. Appreciate both the mayor's presence and Commissioner Sweeney's presence with that. Always a good day to help bring some attention to the respect for the American flag. And along with Commissioner O'Donnell and Town Manager Kathy, we attended the MML convention in June. Ocean City. Always a very interesting event, always very knowledgeable. Always a good chance to meet other people around the state, talk to people about other problems, and you realize that, again, as a small municipality, you're sharing the same problems with everybody else. Water, sewer, police, everything else. It's like, you know, no community seems to be really unique in the state of Maryland as far as unique problems. Everyone's kind of sharing the same deals, and with the classes, you get a chance to kind of see, like, how does everybody actually deal with this in different situations? So, found it useful. So, anyways, thank you.
Great. Thank you, sir. Like I said, I did get some feedback from Kendall Moore, the president of the HOA at Pembroke Woods, related to some activity out there. And I think we've got it so that folks hopefully know it is in their best interest if an event occurs to contact the deputies directly. And it's one of those sort of things, if you see it, say something, you know, literally act on it, 911, just let the police be the judge of what you think is out of the ordinary. Going on to the other items, Mr. Sweeney, I don't want to neglect you. I think basically you did a yeoman's work getting Community Heritage Day together. I know there are committees involved and other organizations, but you ran point on it, and my hat's off to you because it went very smoothly this year, and I didn't hear anybody, you know, unhappy, and your work on the weather was nice. You did a great job with that, too, so hats off there, too.
I do have one complaint.
Oh, really?
I had a spot for you on the float, and you missed it.
I will happily discuss that with you at a better time. But
I
sincerely say I made every effort to be there. Okay, and I was there.
You was in the parade.
I was.
Okay.
I
didn't
see
you. I was at the beginning of the parade.
I spoke to two people with walkie-talkies, and if that's not official, I don't know what is. Okay, nevertheless, moving forward. Like Commissioner Blanchard, like Ms. Willits and Mr. Haller, I did attend the MML session, the Maryland Municipal League Convention, this past week. Very productive stuff. As Mr. Blanchard says, we do share a lot, and the nice thing is we have a lot of resources out there. I do think I found some grants that could be useful to our community. I want to bring back some very specific information about that in the August meeting. There's something that might be a little bit time sensitive I'll talk to the mayor about, but there are new grants that are being funded that had not been funded in the past that really align with what we're trying to do in our community. So I think it would be in our best interest to pursue those. Moving forward from there, I received an email, I think everybody did, from Jimmy Click, related to the lights in town. That was appreciated because I did have questions about that, and it's nice to have that information like straight from the source. I thought that was very helpful. Let's see, the other item just to share, you know, we're a community of communities, and our you know, our friends down the road in Thurmont, John Kinnaird, we all know John, his mother passed away, so I thought I'd share that with you guys and, you know, keep the family in your thoughts if you'd be so kind. Commissioner Mellor, I want to compliment you getting the feedback from your committee so quickly back to the board. And related to Parks and Recreation, two events that I attended down at MML relate to some pretty dynamic park projects, and one was called a cultural project related to art in public spaces. I tried to forward the PowerPoint that I received from everybody. I will try that again. It bounced back to me, so I think I'm doing something wrong, but I will try to push that out to everybody. I think it's a pretty worthwhile PowerPoint for you guys to take a look at. And beyond that, let's see. I did get feedback from some residents related to the heroin issue in town. And there are individuals who are organizing and trying to move forward on some means by which for the community to address it more aggressively. And it sounds like a very grassroots thing, and it sounds like a very positive thing. And the more we learn about it, I hope the more energy we as a board can put behind it in whatever capacities we have. But as we all know, it is a very real thing. It's very real in every community in Maryland. And if we have the means to do something appropriate and positive, I think this is I think we're at a threshold here. I think we can do something that's more than what we have been able to do recently. So, with that having been said, I'll conclude my comments. Thank you. Mr. Mayor, we turn to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much. I did attend the viewing for Mayor John Kinnaird's mother. It was held here in last week at Meyer Duberoff. We attended a joint meeting the state highway on the town square progress meeting, our new town manager and I, and things are going well. They're progressing. We're trying to get a memo of understanding out to them before the fall. I did give a little welcoming speech. We had our joint Emmitsburg Thurmont Flag Day here, and it was attended again by two of our commissioners, Blanchard and Sweeney. Very special time in the park and a very kind of reverent situation. And this week we interview our possibly new HR person. And we'll also have a meeting with the State Highway Administration here this week, talk about the bridge and the completion work up on North Seton and also the square. As I mentioned at Community Heritage Day, again, thank you, Commissioner Sweeney, for everything you did there and that crew, the Joys. We're really pushing something because it was from several ladies in our community about Emmitsburg Cares, and they got together on the street after one house had, I call it a raid, here on the South Seton, not far from our office, and see something, say something, and we're pushing it on our Twitter, Facebook, and everything we've got here, cable, and it's our feature program. You don't have to. I've heard people say, well, this is going on. Why don't you call them? And they say, I don't want to get involved. You can call anonymously. You don't call 911. You call 911 when it's emergency. But if you see something, there is another number. And it's on our all our social media. It's up to us. It's our community. And we have two officers around here. And there's so many things going on. And people maybe get upset when they don't see something immediately happening, but you put it in. You say, get a call in. We get more coverage up here. We get they're building a case. Everything we've done here, and it took a while for the community people around this one house up there to be heard. But you have to build a case and get a warrant. That's our most important thing that Emmitsburg Cares and. It's driven by a couple of ladies in our community. I think that's about all I have right now. Thank you.
Megan. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Oh, wait a minute. We do have a letter. We sent some flowers on behalf of the council and the staff and the mayor to Dr. Joe, our wandering little doctor around town, and we did that for him. And I have a card back from his family that. Thanking us for that, and he'll be sorely missed. He's like our little troubadour. But thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Do we have anybody signed up for public comments? We don't. Okay. All right. So therefore, we move on to administrative business, item J. Well, item J. Okay, we move forward. Okay. We have an item related to Resolution 2016-01R Community Legacy Grant.
I will defer to Ms. Sipperly.
Great. Thank you.
We are once again applying for money from the state to fund our Community Legacy Grant program, which is, as you recall, the 50-50 matching grant of state and private money. The first fiscal year that we got money was 2013, and we have gotten $50,000 each year after that. So this would be for the 2017 fiscal year. We're asking for $75,000, which we did last year, and we got 50. So it doesn't hurt to ask. I think this survey that we did will help to show that we do have a lot of potential projects, and also that we're trying to get the word out. It's already accomplished quite a lot of good improvement on Main Street, especially. So you did one of these for the last 4 years, or this will be the fourth one, and just goes with part of our application. And I just want to mention also that we will be doing another grant application from the same kind of funding. We'll be doing one for the square financing as soon as we figure out what the numbers are. After we talk to State Highway on Friday, we'll have a better number. So you'll be getting another one, I believe, in August. We'll be doing that. But this is just kind of has to be part of the application.
Okay, so are you seeking a vote from the board to put the resolution forward? Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, and to accept the resolution as presented?
Yes. Right.
Is that accurate? Okay,
yes.
All right. Any questions for staff related to the grant? Yes, Mr. Ritz.
Just forgive me, I can't remember from year to year. The $75,000 that we're seeking in grant money, we, the town, we're not responsible for matching any of that. That's just money
right.
from
we're
state
just
and
the
federal
pass,
funds.
We're the pass-through for the
okay.
system, which we write them a letter saying that as an in-kind contribution, we'll, I think the last year it was $10,000 worth at least of staff time and things like copying and that sort of thing. So it's purely, there's no town money involved.
Okay.
Except for staff time.
Administrative fees and stuff. Okay.
This is for next year. And to date, she's fully almost the funding request for 2016, that $50,000. So with the matching funds, we will at the end of this year have put $400,000 into the downtown and the sustainable community area, which is basically our historic area. And this will take us up, and our goal is to get $500,000 or $600,000 worth of work done downtown on buildings that help people do that. And our planner has done a terrific job on that, and with every grant comes management, and it's thick and how to do that, all that stuff, and she's done a great job.
Okay, Mr. Ritz,
I'm satisfied.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay,
thank you.
Great. Sure. Any other questions for staff or related to this item? No. This has been a great program. I mean, it really has. You can see the difference on Main Street with the properties that have been enhanced by this, and you can also see the effect of people who have looked at those who've been affected by it, and they've kind of thrown in also. So it's building a steady momentum, which is very nice. Okay, is there a member of the board who is willing to move this resolution forward?
I'll make a motion to accept resolution 2016-01R as presented.
Very good. Ms. Willis, will that satisfy the need for the language for this?
Yes, that's good.
Great, okay. Is there a second for the motion made by Mr. Ritz?
I'll second.
Thank you. The motion's been made by Commissioner Ritz. It's been seconded by Commissioner Mellor. Is there any further discussion? Okay, hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. The motion carries 5-0. Very good. Thank you, folks. Okay. I have an administrative item question to the board and for town staff. I was approached by someone related to a trail item, and their hope is to build a bridge over I'll call it a V-ditch, for lack of a better description. And what I'd like to know is, from the board and from staff, what might be acceptable to get that approved at a future meeting. And what this would relate to is, basically, would the board and staff accept standards that have been put forward by Montgomery County Parks or the National Park or the State Park or any combination thereof? Would that be permissible and acceptable to staff and the board? That's kind of what I'm trying to figure out.
Is it for a grant? Is it for be grant funded? Or
no, actually, this is someone who's willing to donate it privately, and they're also willing to build it privately. And that's kind of what I want to... I have a couple concerns there. The town would have to accept it and would have to accept the spec and the design. And I don't want to walk out on the trail one day and find that people are now freelancing and building structures out there, which happens in some places. So I want to make sure that we use a process in order to consider these things reasonably, but also I think it's a valuable project, but it's just a question of... an appropriate standard for construction.
Does the town have to accept liability for something like that? I mean, I understand that riding at your own risk is in place there, but if we're going to start putting man-made structures, what kind of liability does that have to the town?
My understanding, it's the liability. Again, it falls to the trail user. If the item is there and it's used, it's designed appropriately and accepted by other entities, that it should be appropriate. Like, the liability would be of the user. I think there's a maintenance, well, I know that there's a maintenance piece on our part. So, for example, over time, as it wears, you know, there'd be an obligation for it to be replaced or removed. So there are some, there certainly are some liability issues.
And typically there is an alternative when you go. When
correct.
You have
yeah. Virtually everything on the trail has an alternative. Okay. And this one goes through a rocky little rivulet, you know, a little streamlet that trickles through.
Yeah.
So we're trying to, this person's thought is if you can span the gap, and it's not a large gap, but if you can span the gap, then you give somebody the alternative to the rough ride through the rocky area. And
okay.
I think it's reasonable, but again, I'm Mr. Cautious, you know, so I want to make sure we're crossing the T's and dotting the I's. So
I'd like to see maybe standards that are already in Frederick County.
Okay.
Since that's where we are, as opposed to a different county. And then as far as maintenance, who's going to be responsible for maintaining it?
It would be us, but basically I would see to it. I mean, basically, you know, through the organization more.
Okay.
So I mean, I'll rephrase that. The town's liable for it. I mean, that's certainly stated, but replacement would fall to more, or removal, because it would be sited in such a way that it's not the main path of the trail. It would be a parallel route of the trail. So were it not there, one could still negotiate it. They just have to use a different level of caution.
Okay.
So, okay. Any other items related to that? No? Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, so. Trying to keep us going, sorry guys. Okay, we have no consent Treasurer. Agenda items, so we now move to the treasurer's report. Mr. Blanchard?
Sure, thank you, Mr. President. Town of Emmitsburg cash activity as of June 28, 2016, $4,049,919 cash balance June 1st, 2016, and $4,342,302 operating balance forward. And as always, you have the top 10 check amounts, the vendor names, descriptions, and so forth.
Okay, are there any questions for Mr. Blanchard or for staff related to these items presented? No? Okay, all right, hearing none, we'll move forward. Okay, thank you, Mr. Blanchard. Okay, we now press on to our agenda items, and we did switch, so, I'm sorry.
I did have one question
sure.
I'm about to ask about this.
Yes, sir.
Concerning the sign that was vandalized outside of town, the Welcome to Emmitsburg sign.
Yes.
What is the timeline as far as replacement is concerned?
Well, we're looking at a location, and we're going to make some suggestions and maybe put it on the agenda August that we were talking about today, our staffing. It's just that it seems too vulnerable out there.
Yeah, that's one kind of fear too. But that's just
maybe retreat it back into the corporate limits. I don't know if that'll help or not, but it was.
Just every time I drive by those stumps, I kind of like, I get a little angry.
So
you got to do some sort of welcome sign.
It's also been submitted to the insurance company.
Okay, that's why
I figured
that had to be some sort of insurance claim type thing too. So, okay, thanks. Sorry, Mr. President.
Sure, no. I think there's other things we could do to armor it, figuratively speaking. I mean, to make it less, you know, choice of target. Sure. Okay, so we press on. All right, we move to agenda item number 3, which we bumped forward. Discussion related to metrics of the town website. This is something I asked for. Ms. Ray, thank you very much. We look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Okay, so everyone should have some documents. I gave out some graphs, charts.
Can you see it, though? You want me to turn this light back on?
No, this is good. It's good. Are you guys okay?
I'm fine.
As is?
Okay. Yeah. If you can see the screen, that's fine as well. It looks kind of small. But basically, we're using Google Analytics, which is free. And it's, you know, very useful, especially for a low-level traffic website as ours. So it is free. It gives you a lot of information, even far more in-depth than what I think we're looking for. But this is the page that it comes up on, and this The first chart right here is an overview of the audience. It shows that this is for last week, for the 26th through July 2nd. We had 503 sessions. A session is like when anybody goes onto the page. Anyone goes onto the site, rather. And those 503 sessions were done by 405 users. So there were at least 100 that were second-time visitors within a certain time period, so that they don't count as a new session, because maybe it was in the same day or things of that nature. Page views is kind of self-explanatory. So within that week, last week, there were 1,478 pages used, and you know, included in all of the sessions. And the user stays on a page the pages viewed. They tend to use about three pages per session once they come into our website, and that could take up to around almost 2 minutes for each user that logs on. Does this making sense?
Yes.
Okay, good. The bounce rate was the first thing I looked at that caught me off guard, but it's actually, this is a number that you want to keep low, because basically it's when, let's say I did a search for Emmitsburg Pool on Google, and it pops up, it takes you directly to the pool page on our website. So, and that would mean I clicked on that, went directly to the pool page, found out what I needed to know, and closed it. So that means that's what makes up a bounce rate, because you didn't go any other pages. You just went to one page and left the website. So, I mean, of course, the goal would be to get people to look at more pages than one when they come onto the page. So that's something that we'll have to work on and see how we can change that. And, of course, the majority of the sessions are new users, because the website is so new. So we're going to have a lot of new users for a while. As it goes down, it has some stuff about demographics and language and things of that nature that I didn't find that useful personally. But
before you go,
Can
you click on city?
Sure.
Okay, and I don't have my glasses on. Does that say Thermont?
Yeah, that is actually interesting. Emmitsburg is number 5.
Okay.
That's so weird, when Thermont is number 1.
So does that mean we have the most hits from the Thermont community?
Thermont, yeah.
Hagerstown.
From Thermont.
Hagerstown's right below us.
Yeah.
Number 6.
Thurman's always been interested in what we do.
I was getting ready to say, a lot of people are looking at us to see what we're doing.
Oh, so that's okay.
That's funny.
Now, if Emmitsburg. We could just get some more Emmitsburg residents to look and see what we're doing.
I think we will. I mean, this is new enough, but I think this is the right direction for sure, for certain.
Okay.
What this tells me, because I see that you have a lot of pages visit. I'm sorry, Terry, I don't mean to jump ahead.
No, it's fine.
But there are a lot of pages. The swimming pool had 181 page views.
Mm-hmm.
So what this tells me is that people from Thermont and perhaps people from Frederick and maybe Hagerstown are looking to come to our swimming pool.
Mm-hmm.
Does Hagerstown have a municipal swimming pool? Do you know?
I thought they did.
They do?
I thought they did.
Who was that?
Know. Does Hagerstown have a municipal pool?
They have to.
I don't know.
Yeah.
I know we
Thermont
got it.
Thermont does not.
Right,
Thermont.
Right. Yeah. And I was curious to see if maybe Tawnytown was on there.
Got some great compliments on the trash pickup since it was moved to today. It was easy to find for when I hear from people. It was up to date and very good job, Terry. That a lot of raves on that.
Cool. All right. Any more questions on this one? Basically, the next thing, I was just going to show you a comparison because I chose last week's data, and I can make a comparison to the previous period, so that'll give us 2 weeks worth of data to see where we were the week before last versus last week. And you can see that the usage is down as of this past week. And this one right here, the biggest day we had was on June 25th, which was Heritage Day. And I think that probably has a lot to do with the number of sessions that we have, because it was, that was a really high usage day. But you know, you can compare and see week to week whether, like, that was certain events, a certain event that was going on that was drawing more attention. And it gives you still all the same data. You can just compare from week to week, which would include the cities. So you can see the change between from week to week. And Thurmont, they're really killing it there. I don't understand why that. Okay, so the next one, there's a few more.
Terry.
Yes.
I have a question, and you mentioned too. I'm not very computer oriented, but the Jennifer mentioned to me that since the 25th was the highest day, is there any way the Heritage Day to be added to the page, or maybe, I don't know how, maybe if that's what they were clicking on to?
Right, there is a link. There was a link. It was very prominent. You could see anything that had Heritage Day. There was a link there to Emmitsburg events.
Oh, I didn't even know you had. She just had mentioned it.
Oh, yeah. Because we got a lot of calls. Starting from like a month prior about.
Oh, okay.
Different events.
I'll make
that.
Sure this goes on our website too.
Great.
Jen, because we have EmmitsburgEvents.com, mm-hmm. and then she has another website. That way, our website gets out more.
Right. Yeah, that's fine.
I mean, what you guys are really talking about is this notion of the cross-sell, and this is something that was talked about at MML a couple summers ago. This is really the first time we've had the chance to kind of see what's out there. And one of the things they talked about was when you have a very visible page, you put in an ad for another service the town provides. Like, you post the question, did you know you could pay your water bill online? Mm-hmm. Something akin to that. And that way you start training your population. So it requires less office visits for them, convenience-wise, and less task time for in-house staff.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the kind of thing I'm hoping that we can see as an outcome.
Yeah, that's part of the search engine optimization, where when someone searches, these things come up as the top 10 on your browser of the places that are searched. On the page. Do you have the part, I don't know what it's called, Terry, where it shows the home page and then you can put your clicker over the link and it'll tell you the number of clicks on that link?
Let me see.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
I'm not 100% sure, but I'm going to look at this one thing I was actually going to show. Actually, I want to turn off the comparison. Okay. So I think this is what you're talking about. These are the top 10 pages that were viewed on our website last week. And a couple things I do want to point out. I'm not 100% sure why. It could be some navigational explanation, but yeah, look at that. This page right here with just a slash, that's the home page. Okay, so 317 page views. I want to go back a second. Hold on. For that, but also this one, number six. These are the same page as number one. So, and I think it just has to do with the way it was programmed, because when I click on them, it goes to the same place. The same is correct for number two and number four. Those are both, they both go directly to the pool pages. So, it still basically says that number one is the home page and number two is the pool page as the most popular. And then the rest of them fall under that. The next being the calendar, the next being the trail. This one that says revise in front of it, that's probably me. Because Revise is the website provider, so that means I was in there editing something. And then people are looking at water and sewer and the business index, and us, the staff members. So that's the top items that people are looking at on the page. Did you want any more specifics?
Do they go on for the community legacy program? Do you know?
I have, I could dig a little deeper to see. But like I said, in the top, I would say, I guess that's like the top eight, because a couple of those are combined. Let me go to the next page. If everybody can see where I'm seeing, I am not seeing legacy.
We do have some community legacy information on the homepage. She has it under the latest news. So if they're just looking for something basic, they would get that off the homepage also.
Mm-hmm. But here you can see our most popular pages. And that's pretty much it that I have to show you. If you have more questions or you know, if there's something more we can find, by all means, let me know.
Is there anything you'd recommend that we do? Like anything you're wanting to consider or experiment with?
Well, the first thing, as far as the one thing that we do not have, I want to see is a frequently asked questions page. And we had discussed that initially, but it just, you know, there's been a lot of other pages that we're working on. And I think that also would go to contribute to, like, you know, do you know you can pay your water bill online, things of that nature. And just using Facebook to try to direct people and Twitter to direct people to our website more. And in general, we still need more Facebook and Twitter followers. So, but it, you know, it seems kind of hard to get. We just keep pushing it. It's got on our email signatures and everything. And then with the, I feel like I'm going out of my lane here, but we just sent out the water bills that have a page in them to fill out all of your information, and that includes updating your phone number and your email address and signing up for the email update list, which is definitely going to generate some more traffic as well, I think. So, you know, we just keep plugging along as things come up, or I notice things on other pages, then we... Kathy and I discuss it.
Great. Okay, because number one, it's a good website. It's far more useful than what we did have. I mean, obviously, the technology handicapped us before. It's definitely more useful than what was there. It's good to see that you're considering, you know, modifying it as we go along, because I think that's what's going to keep people revisiting. Mm-hmm. And just sort of on the aesthetic side, the photos were good. I always try to push for photos of people. I mean, it's great to see all those places, but, you know, people, because people want to see people. The other side is, yeah, the metrics, I think, is super important, because it tells us what we need to do, I think. Like, are we able to pay parking tickets through the website? Is that it? Is that, we can't do that? Is there a reason why we can't do that?
Because right now we have online, and this is something that we have been working on with Mr. Tabler. Right now all we have is water and sewer bills online through the company that we're utilizing.
Okay.
He has been doing a lot of research, getting some different vendors to see what we could do as far as enhancing our bill pay online. And this brought up something I was going to bring up later, was we are getting ready to put a credit card swipe machine at the front desk.
Mm-hmm.
And that will at least allow people to come in and pay parking tickets, pavilion requests, water, sewer, to a limit at the front desk with credit card. So we're making progress.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah,
you're welcome.
Yeah. That's great. I think the more convenient we make things for people, the easier it's going to be for all parties involved, and like those who we serve, and to take care of our needs here. What was the other item? Regarding reservations for pavilions, I know we're going to talk about that at a future time, but is there any means by which that can be done online that's reasonable? Or
not at this time. The only thing we're capable of taking online is the water and sewer bills.
Did Westminster do that, or did they have to come into the office to make reservation? Do you know, for facility rental or reservation?
They had, they were implementing a system to do all of that as I was exiting. So I think that right now they act, I don't know what it's called, but it was for scheduling their parks and their pavilions and paying gym membership. It was for the whole shebang. Mm-hmm. It was very, very expensive.
Okay. Yeah, there's the fees and the percentages.
Yeah, and just to have it all installed and right. training your employees to use it and all that. It's a monster. Can I ask, and I might be wrong about this, but is the pool membership application on the pool page?
The application, no.
Why not?
I'm not sure. Why not? It wasn't given to me to put on the page.
Okay.
The rates are on there, but yeah. you have to actually come in and fill, you know, get the form filled out and pick up your pool passes.
Wouldn't it be more convenient for whoever processes those applications and for the customer to be able to pre-fill that application out before they come in?
I think so, probably, yeah.
Right. Oh, yeah, they'd have to come in person to verify their address, but at least they would have the form filled out and ready to go instead of coming in here and standing at your counter filling it out.
Yeah, I don't see why we couldn't do that.
That would be helpful, I think.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, 10 people ask you, it takes you 30 seconds to find it, maybe. You know, that's 5 minutes of time that might not be necessary. You know, here's my form, please consider. I mean, that could be true for any form.
Well,
I mean,
and for the customer, it's convenient. Sure. They're not saying, well, I'm not going to go in there and fill it out. You know, they might think that it's too much of an inconvenience and not come in.
Cut some corners. Yeah, sure.
We do that for the parks. The form is available for download online.
Yeah, I saw that.
So, you know, when you can either email it to me back to me and then mail your check or whichever is most convenient for the person, but you can get the form online.
Now, we had discussed pool passes, two free pool passes with memberships. Did anybody ever follow through with that?
I thought that was part of last year's the pool not opening on time decision.
So that wasn't something that carried over into this year? Okay.
So maybe for consideration for next year, go back to that.
I don't know. I thought it was, I guess I'm in a
Amy, how many pool, whatever, did
yeah,
we
how
saw
are we
this
doing
year?
With that this year? Is it, are memberships up, down?
They're about the same. We've got probably about, I have to count them over there. I think there's 15 passes family passes that we've done. So it's your time, what takes the time is filling out the passes. It's not filling out the form.
Right.
Sure, sure. Those 15 passes, Amy, don't they represent about 58 people?
I think I gave
you that. Yeah, right. And an average daily count last year was 70 people used the pool per day.
And I heard you mention the pool party. We have a pool party coming up this Friday?
Friday.
Yeah.
Ooh, okay. 7 to 9 this Friday. Okay.
Since we're on the pool, I have something to bring up. Sure. I had a couple of people approach me about why the pool does not open Memorial Day anymore, because I know we're doing it for school reason, but most of there's a lot of pay. The children don't pay the taxes and to keep the pool open. The residents do, and they wanted to know why they aren't allowed to use the pool. They have to wait till the kids get out of school. I didn't know what to tell them. I know it opened up. Well, we always waited till the kids got out of school, but
that right, that would be a decision for the board. As it's been in the years past, the contract was always when the first day or the last day of school is when the pool would open. If there would be a change to that, that would be something, a decision that you guys would have to make. I don't know why. I don't know why that day was picked, but that's just the way it's been in the contracts.
And in my opinion, it would be okay to open it on the weekends until school closes, but I don't think that it's cost effective to keep it open through the week.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah, and it's not worth to pay the staff and the chemicals and supplies.
I was only bringing, you know, asked me why it was changed, and I said, well, I'll bring it up, and we was talking about the pool, but, and said that we like to use the pool when the kids aren't there anyway. So.
Yeah.
So it was seniors and some grown-ups who brought it up, but I mentioned it, so.
So I guess this, one thing I think may be coming moving forward from this, if that's okay, considering approaching the departments and town staff and find out what documents could be posted online so they could be easily downloaded and filled in. Like something that I run into with the trail users, whether it's a cyclist or a dog walker or a trail runner, they're always pressing for more than just Sundays during the hunting seasons. And I know that some hunting seasons are more engaged than others, and I don't want to encroach on that, but at the same time, if there was a means by which we could categorize the hunting seasons on the hunting licenses, I think maybe we could kind of track that and maybe give that consideration. But more importantly, aside from that, approaching departments, finding out what documents can go out there to be pre-filled and brought into town for the staff, and maybe that might help expedite things. And I guess, do we know when Mr. Tabler is going to come back with other information related to paying things online?
I have a meeting with him tomorrow at 11.
Okay,
it will be on my list to ask.
Great, okay. That's a big help.
I know the credit card swipe machine has already been ordered.
Sure.
So that we'll be bringing something back to you guys next month on that.
Like the fishing documents and all that could be put on there for you getting a fish permit, but they have to still come and show their ID.
Right.
Well, the fishing and the hunting, they're duplicate. Forms, mm-hmm. So you can't really do that online because they're like carbon forms.
Oh, okay.
You know, we keep a copy and then they have to take one. So that's not one that we could really do. And they're forms we get from the state.
Is that from DNR?
They're actually printed by Chronicle Press, but I never knew where the forms actually originated from.
Okay.
I don't know.
Okay.
But if the website's a work in progress. Terry's done a phenomenal job with it.
Yes,
yeah. And so I know I'm always open to suggestions, and Terry is as well, to continue to improve it. So as you guys see something, please suggest it.
Sure.
And I've said all along, if you have pictures, please send them.
And kickball, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So let's move on to our next agenda item, if that's okay with everybody. Is that all right? Okay. Okay, very good. So we now move on to what is listed now as agenda item number one, discussion concerning sidewalk maintenance in front of homes and businesses. And Mr. Mayor, is that yourself or Ms. Sipperly?
No, it's going to start over there with the planner Sipperly.
Okay.
And I'll go.
Good luck. Remember, fast and bouncy.
Thank you.
Right? You know,
go win one.
How do you want your pitch?
I haven't played that game in some years.
That should be off. You ready? Or are we waiting for the mayor to come back?
He's sitting back there putting his leg up.
Oh.
Oh,
okay. This ordinance was suggested at least one meeting ago, maybe two, to sort of augment the wording we had about litter and things on the sidewalks and who was responsible for cleaning it up. We sent a draft to our town attorney, who provided wording about how to enforce it. So basically, in addition to the original wording was just referred to nuisances, litter, trash, and debris, but we got a little more specific. Is it not including but not limited to newspapers, smoking debris, trash, and other types of litter? Upon observing an accumulation of debris, trash, or other litter in violation of this section, the town may send a written warning to the owner and or occupier of the property adjoining the sidewalk in violation, and inform that person of the requirements of this section, give them 10 days to correct the violation. If it's not corrected within that time period,
you can get a $25 fine. And subsequent to that, if there's another violation at the same location within a 10-day period, you can get a $50 fine. So pretty simple. It gives people plenty of warning, in my opinion. 10 days is plenty of time to either get a letter out or a phone call and give somebody plenty of time to go out and clean up whatever it is. That's all I have to say about it.
Okay. Any questions for staff related to what's in front of us? Mr. Ritz?
Questions or comments?
Sure, either or. That's fine.
This ordinance that's presented to us reminds me of some other ones we've seen in the past, and I feel that the intent is, it's a good intent. But again, I have issue with it. Namely, it's almost like we're being ordinanced to death, pardon the expression, but if somebody has trash in front of their house, I admit it might not look pretty, but who are we to enforce that? If they want to live with a bunch of trash in front of their house, so be it. It's not like a homeowners association where you have to sign, I guess, a contract. I don't know. I never lived in a development with an HOA in place.
Well, I think it's talking about the sidewalks and footways. Not so much like the front yard necessarily.
Well, a lot of the houses downtown, and I see the mayor coming up, and I believe someone connected to him does help clean up the town, which I commend her for doing. But a lot of the sidewalks running down Main Street, you know, they butt up right against the house, and that's probably where a lot of the trash accumulates. You know, I for one, live on North Seton Avenue, and if somebody is just walking past my house smoking a cigarette and starts flicking the cigarette butts, I'm going to be a little annoyed at that individual, and I'm going to tell them they need to clean it up, not myself. Why should I be fined for that? That's all. That's jumping out at me as being an issue. Perhaps it's the way it's worded. I don't know. I know it went to the town attorney, but I'm also focusing on the next part, which we didn't discuss yet, the sidewalk. Should I wait for that?
No, go ahead.
The way I'm reading the sidewalk repair, we had a lot of sidewalks just put in town. The way I'm reading this is that if any sidewalk is out of repair, should be repaired or relayed, the mayor shall notify the owner by notice in writing to repair. So that homeowner has 20 days to fix the situation. So if my next door neighbor gets annoyed at me and takes a sledgehammer to my sidewalk in front of my house, I'm responsible for that?
Well, if you can document it, no.
If I can catch him doing it, but if let's say he does it in the middle of the night, now I have nothing against my neighbor. He's not going to do such a thing. But should he do that, you know, in the middle of the night, no one can figure it out, then why am I responsible for that? And I'm using myself as an example. I think this could relate to anyone in town, really.
Here's my thought. Your examples present some hyperbole, you know, not the cigarette butt thing, and I understand what you're saying. But I think what we're trying to do is to maintain a sense of cleanliness in town. You know, our job, you know, our first and foremost jobs, you know, health, safety, transit, you know, the community accessibility and safety. So I think for trash in a sidewalk or a footway, you know, that in my view, that absolutely has to be maintained. And if I'm looking at this correctly, this is the old language where it's in the basic print. The bold print is the modification. So what's here already exists to a point, and I think that's true starting with whenever the statement. So we already are obligated to enforce this. Okay. I mean, when you ran for office, you signed off that you were going to enforce these things. Mm-hmm. Now, what we're modifying relates to what the bold print says, and that is, I agree with you, that, you know, that's what we really do have to consider. But with somebody attacking your property, I understand. That's an extreme example, and I think that under that circumstance, you'd be able to put forward some witnesses potentially, but at the same time, you know, a hit and run event. Yeah, I understand. I do. You know, some damage on that side. But if you look at our main street and if you look at the, like our neighborhood streets, we want to have this walkability piece in place, and mm-hmm. we want it to be a safe and clean environment for our kids and for our elderly and for ourselves, and we want it to also be an inviting environment.
Okay.
And if we have a tolerance of, you know, certain things, we set a tone for the neighborhood where we're going to tolerate other, you know, other issues, and it doesn't serve us well because over time it accumulates.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not necessarily one for zero tolerance, and I think that's kind of maybe where your lean is. Maybe. I don't want to put words in your mouth.
No, I mean, maybe this relates back to what I brought up at another meeting, too, about the Main Street communities of Thurmont and Tonytown, which, in my opinion, look a lot better than our downtown. I don't know if that has anything to do with it. I don't know if this ordinance will help. I know we approved another ordinance in the past where we were to fine homeowners for putting out pieces of, like, you know, an old beat up couch in their front yard or on their front porch. It didn't look nice, so they'd be fine. But to this day, I still see some houses within town limits with said beat up couches and whatnot on their front porch.
Okay, well, share that with town staff, and maybe that'll change. Yeah. I mean, we all have an obligation on this. I mean, that's kind of the thing. Like, we try to not pick and choose what we're enforcing. And I understand what you're saying. I mean, we do have to live here.
Am I in the minority here and speaking out? I mean, I don't know if anyone up here. I'm just going on. No one else has been given the opportunity to jump in. So, you know, perhaps I'm the only one.
There is one thing, though. I ran an incident today with vehicle parked on the sidewalk. I've seen a lot through town, a lot of people, if they're unloading something, or especially if they live, don't have parking on Main Street, will park on the sidewalks. So, and if what happens if they break it when they are parking there, unloading something, they drive across yours and break it. So, I mean, I've seen it, and somebody was fined today for doing that, which is what they're supposed to be done, fined for parking on the sidewalk. But I've seen it on other places in town, too, other than, you know. And if we put brand new sidewalks in, they're going to get broke up by pulling onto the sidewalk.
That's why we have to continue to enforce things like that. He did come in here, was extremely unhappy, but it has to be enforced.
But, I mean, other than him, I mean, other than today, I've seen it mm-hmm. with people moving, with moving vans and other things, especially with the sidewalks for flat and level on Main Street and on North Seton. They can pull right onto the sidewalk. So, I mean, I don't know how we enforce it, you know, if their sidewalk's broke then, but.
Well, if it can be enforced, it needs to be enforced. I mean, I know it's an office hours thing, or, you know, with.
That's the only thing I would see about maybe.
With the county, you know, the sheriffs and such, but.
Even the mailman I've seen pull on the sidewalk.
Yeah, they have a different authority, the federal piece. But but I think the bigger picture here is we're trying to improve the town by maintaining and potentially raising our standards and expectations. And if you feel that Thurmont has a better Main Street, and if you feel that Tawnytown has a better Main Street, I would suspect possibly they have ordinances like this that okay. they're enforcing. And I think that's part of the standard that they've put forward, saying we want to tolerate less of this in order to enhance, you know, our community, to make our place a better place. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'll go to the absolute extreme. You know, I've been overseas in Germany, and, you know, trash is gone almost when it hits the ground. And, you know, it's a different culture, I guarantee you. But the outcome is it's pretty impressive. I mean, you can go into any part of a community on the spectrum of income, and there's a dramatic sense of pride of place. And, you know, people care about where they live, and I hope that in our community we feel the same way.
Well, yeah, I think a majority of us do. I mean, I wouldn't want anything on my sidewalk.
Sure,
you know,
sure.
It doesn't look nice, and it's an obstacle. It's a hazard, but it's amazing what you can find, though. up against the house, you know.
Sure.
I don't have sidewalks in front of my house. But I've cleaned and swept the street, up the street, because when the rain comes down, everything goes by, it brings all the trash and the rocks and stuff down. It does lay all over the front of your street, and people probably thought I was crazy with sweeping the broom, you You'd be surprised how much stuff collects in front of your house.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I've swept the square. I've swept the square. I've swept behind the baseball diamonds and the bleachers. And, you know, there are bunches of places where things do accumulate. And it does take away from our community. So my hope is we give this consideration. I don't agree with all of it. There's something I'd like to see modified potentially. The notion, you know, one of my big concerns are these sequoias growing up through the sidewalks, weeds and such. So I don't know if we want to add plants or plant debris or organic material, but I would like that to be given consideration if it's not elsewhere stated. The other piece is in looking at what other communities do, and I think we do it elsewhere, relates to the penalty of the warnings and the fees, where at some point in town, the town will step in, they'll affect the repair or they'll clean, and they bill the property owner for the services rendered.
Yeah, that was my question. Is that how it works? Is the homeowner responsible for to hire a contractor to replace the sidewalk, or is that something that the town does and then bills the homeowner? Does town staff do it? Do we have a contractor that we typically use? How's that work?
I believe it's a little bit of both. I think there's some ordinances that are written that you have so much time to fix, and if you don't, then the staff will go in and fix it, and then you will be billed. For example, the foreclosed properties that we have to cut their grass, it's added to their tax bill, and it's going to be collected at some point. The sidewalk, I'm not familiar with not 100% familiar with the sidewalk ordinance. I'd have to look that up. But my understanding is it is up to the property owner to fix it. If they don't fix it, I don't know what the time constraints are. I believe then staff would go in and have to make the repair or contract who we normally use, and then they would be billed. But that is something I can look into further.
Right. Well, and that and you know, there has to be some guidelines put forth as to what materials can be used, because, you know, if you tell me I have to redo my sidewalk, you know,
asphalt.
Well, I mean, you have to say that, yeah. What do you want it to be? And then does it have to meet certain guidelines? Like,
and I'm sure there probably are guidelines and standards. I would have to look it up.
Right.
And just a thought, our sidewalks, number one, we've been very lucky with the grants that we've run into. I mean, these have been really a godsend. But in talking to other folks from other communities, again, this MML piece, in Brunswick, I think the consideration was the town provided, I don't know if it was grant funded, but the town provided a zero interest loan where the homeowner was basically loaned money from the municipality, and they had a period of time to make good on the borrowing. And that went to the repair to the town, the city of Brunswick standard. For the sidewalks, I don't know if they've enacted that yet or not. I know there was I had a discussion with somebody down there related to that, but I thought that was a pretty forward-thinking way of addressing it, where funds get set aside, and a zero-interest loan is provided. So, I don't think we have huge sections of sidewalk that are being sledgehammered in the middle of the night, but if that happens, you know, maybe.
That was worst-case scenario.
Yeah, sure. very visual.
If I may. Just make a comment here on the one that's before us. It was mostly to make sure to assign responsibility for litter. And it doesn't say the town has to send, it says the town may send a written warning. It's pretty almost friendly language for, it doesn't say shall find them. And so it was just kind of, well, if some of the places we get comments about are in the downtown area, and sometimes the owner of the property does go out and sweep it and clean up cigarette butts, and as soon as somebody else walks by, they flick. Cigarette butts are a big part of the problem, but so are the newspapers that nobody asks to have thrown on their sidewalk. So it's just, who's going to do it? The town staff doesn't need to be out there sweeping the sidewalks. So it's sort of traditionally been people's responsibility that own the property adjacent to it. And in a place like Brookville or something, that is part of your Let's see, it varies. Sometimes the property line comes up to the inside of the sidewalk, but it's kind of like shoveling snow. Everybody's got a community responsibility to make it passable. And it may just seem like an aesthetic thing, but it does affect the how people view the, especially the downtown. So as I'm just trying to say, it's not, it gives us somebody to assign responsibility to and get it cleaned up. And 10 days is a pretty long time.
Yeah, I mean, I'm torn on this. I think it's the intent. I support the intent. It may be, and I'm not a very good communicator. I'm not the most eloquent of individuals, or maybe even my writing. I don't know what to suggest to change if we keep this. And I guess too, I'm also thinking, you know, who's going to actually enforce it? I think of Amy over here. You know, other duties as assigned. Is that what she's going to have to do? So, I don't know. I'm open to suggestions. I'm assuming we're not going to maybe not vote on this tonight. Maybe I don't know. Think of rewarding, perhaps. I just don't know what to recommend.
Mr. Blanchard.
When I look at this, I'm looking at situations that are so egregious that you can't miss it. You're driving down Main Street, you see someone's yard is just trash.
Exactly.
And I think the town does have a responsibility to go, you know what? You got to take care of this.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about the one person that has like the cigarette butt in the corner of their yard or a little tiny corner like this. I'm talking about a situation that's so egregious, every neighbor around it goes, you know what? This is disgusting. And I do think the town needs to have some upper hand on this about taking care of the situation. I would love to think that everyone has responsibility to take care of themselves, but they don't. And sometimes it does take people basically going, you know what? You got to take care of the situation now or you're going to get fined. And that's why I look at this ordinance. Basically, this is an egregious situation. I don't expect Amy to be walking around every single house and go, you know, I think I found the cigarette butt in the corner of your house. Oh, my God, we're going to give you a fine. No, it's situations that are just so blatant.
Well, I see it's not
just her. It's all of us driving down the street going, you know what? This is ridiculous.
I see some, too, that especially in, like, the village zone where it's not so much one cigarette butt, but, like, you know, they accumulate.
Yeah.
They just start blowing up against the building and it just
correct
pile.
Right.
My interpretation is like when it becomes so blatant that it's like sort of an eyesore that you're like no one can really kind of ignore it. I think something needs to be done at some point. You know, maybe that's fine.
And I may again also,
yes, ma'am.
A lot of that type of thing is complaint driven. Somebody calls the office rather, and we do a incident report which generates an enforcement action. We're not going to be going out and
hunting down.
So it really is complaint driven.
I felt bad for Amy on that. I wasn't insinuating that she should do it.
Well, here's the question: Is Amy the person who would enforce that, or would that come from planning and zoning, or where does enforcement?
Amy can be eyes and ears for enforcement of a lot of things, and so are other people on the town staff because they're out more. Like if somebody's grass is 18 inches tall, they will mention it to us and. We do get people calling up. I just had one yesterday about their neighbor's grass. And so that's what I call a complaint-driven enforcement. And I think that would be more likely what this would be, somebody going.
So who writes the ticket, though? I mean, who writes the citation? Would that come from your office, from yourself, or the town manager?
We would write the warning letter. Basically, it's the planning and zoning and code enforcement office.
Okay. So Amy would have some latitude there, or the ticket enforcement staffer would have some latitude on that one. Does that help? I mean, give you clarity on the issue? Mr. Ritz?
I suppose.
Okay.
I think so.
I think our downtown will look like Thurmont and Tawny Town in about a year and a half. We replace all the sidewalks in the square, and as already can see the difference on the north and south seat and what that's done. We have a little issue with the way they've they haven't completed north seat, and we want to work with them on it. But really what this start coming about is you go in and comment
the same habitual things are happening at properties, and just stand out front flicking cigarettes or cramming the trash cans downtown with their own trash because they don't want to walk around the back and put it in the dumpster and stuff like that. And that we just need, we are working with property owners and everything, but we got to have a little, be able to stop it, especially since we're putting about $3 million into our downtown within next year, and you don't want to have the same problems.
Okay, so to give direction to staff, are we satisfied with the language as it's presented, or do we want to modify it? I mean, I would lean toward something mentioning, you know, organic material or plant debris or, you know, weeds and sidewalks or something more straightforward. Does that
right?
Does anybody else want to see something akin to that, or
sounds? Sounds like, I mean, something about organic banner, yeah.
Organic, sidewalks, yeah. Okay, all right. Commissioner Ritz, would you be okay with that modification?
Sure, yeah, if we're going to. Yeah, let's put that in there, too.
Okay. Commissioner Miller?
That's fine.
Commissioner Sweeney?
That's fine.
Okay. The question came up relating to the town's piece to affect the repair or cleanup. Is that something we want to see the language also included on, or do we want to leave it open-ended at this time? Okay, the idea that at some point in time, if the property owner continued to neglect the issue, the town would step in and affect the cleaning or the repair, and at that time, bill the property owner.
Commissioner, sure. Maybe to Commissioner Miller's comment that maybe we put something in it that if you're going to fix your, it has to be the town's specifications.
And, the town's, okay.
And then we give them a time. If they don't do it, then we do it. And
okay.
We'll put some language into that. And we'll get a spec sheet out on that.
So that'd be modifying the existing sidewalk.
Okay. Would anyone have an issue? We didn't have anyone sign up for town comment. If Mr. Walker, were a resident, were to provide a public comment?
Nope, no issue for me.
We're okay with that, Mr. Mayor? We're okay with that? Mr. Walker, thank you. If you would come forward, identify yourself, your address.
I'm Mark Walker.
And your address?
9436 Waynesboro Pike.
And your comment. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I'm not quite sure about the language of that. Is that mentioned that there will be a sending a note to the owner or to the tenant? I mean, does the tenant, because I believe the tenant should get the notice first, and then if that's not, then the owner would get it.
It does state, and I was questioning that myself, the owner and or occupier of the property.
Owners and occupiers.
It says, it shall be the duty of all owners and occupiers of land to keep the sidewalks and footways bounding thereon in good and proper repair and at all times free of nuisances.
Oh,
and
it continues. Part, though.
Is that sufficient
so
for what
you're concerned?
So if
the owner's not aware of it.
We'll make him aware of it. We want to make him aware of it because we don't have a record of the tenants, but we have the record of the ownership.
Okay. So they would be mailed not to the house or it'd be to the P.O. box or whatever.
Be to the owner.
Well, address the board and I'll ask staff for you. It's just protocol. Okay, so town staff, question for you. Mr. Walker posed the question related to notification. Would it go to both the tenant and the property owner, or how do we manage that?
Normally, we send it to the owner because, for one thing, we don't always know the tenant name. And I would have to look at whether the town attorney specified this language in the new part. Because if we don't, I suppose it would have given us leeway to notify them both or letter to the owner with a copy to the tenant if we know it.
Okay, let me bring it to the board. Board? Okay, so the question at hand is, in response, there does seem to be logic to both identify the tenant as the recipient of the notice as well as the property owner. Does anybody have a concern if staff were to pursue that for both?
That's fine.
We're okay with that?
How do you do both?
Okay, Ms. Miller.
Is that way the owner can let the tenant know? Did you have to clean up the front or something?
So you want everybody on the same page? Is that what I understand? Yeah. Okay. Commissioner Miller, would you be comfortable with that, or you're?
There's a lot of rental units in town.
Correct.
Yeah.
we would always know the owner.
I don't know. I think occupier seems unnecessary because it's going to fall on the owner at the end of the day, isn't it?
Well, it could, but if you have a tenant who's going to act on it, I mean, you might want to act. My thought is, and if I understand, Mr. Walker, let me ask you, what's your rationale for informing both? I'll let you speak on this, and then I'll come
I believe that they should be informed at the same time.
If we can.
Okay. Well, if the tenant has a P.O. box or a...
Don't know their name.
Or a physical address.
That's fine with me.
Okay, all right, so...
I'm not going to fight you over it.
So can we pursue with the attorney the idea of informing the occupant and
the owner,
the property owner?
Well, that's the way that it's written, a warning to owner and or occupier. But the problem is most of these rental properties, we don't know who the tenant is.
Yeah, I mean, why not?
I mean, we don't register rental properties, so.
Because ultimately the owner is going to have to take it up with the tenants if the tenants are the ones that are doing the littering.
No, I agree.
And if they're littering, they're not going to care. They're going to throw that in the trash and forget about it. Or throw it out on the front.
Yeah, throw it in the front of the sidewalk. Yeah, lovely, lovely. Okay.
And also the case of a multi-tenant building.
Okay.
Yeah, you might have a multi-tenant building.
There's so many different scenarios.
The owner collects rent. He should be involved in this.
We want the owner involved,
multiple
sure.
Units, yeah, multiple units. Yeah, yeah. I understand.
Okay, but with the tenant thing, okay, so maybe I missed something. So, Ms. Sipperly, I thought when you spoke, you said that it's just the property owner, but is it both who are informed? Because that's what I think, Ms.
The way it's written... The way this is written, it says owner and or occupier of the property in the new language, and I didn't do this ordinance.
Okay.
So
okay.
I would question how much authority we have over the occupier. And eventually, if somebody had to go to court, unless we saw somebody actually littering, what we do if eventually you could even put a lien against a property or something if they didn't pay their tickets or whatever.
Right.
You
sure.
can't really put a lien against the occupier. So I would like to check with the attorney on that language as to how we could pursue the giving the occupier a ticket or even a copy of the letter if we don't know who they are.
Could it ever just be addressed to tenant? I mean, I get a lot of mail to tenant. I don't know there's
Depends
the moral.
On whether there are 6 or 16
okay.
units and who knows who's doing it. And,
sure.
And I have called landlords sometimes when there's been an issue and just on an informal basis said, you know, could you talk to your tenants? And they go, oh, sure. You know, and it actually helps without... doing this, but this would not. The informal approach sometimes works and
sure.
and sometimes doesn't. So, but I will ask the attorney about the occupier.
Okay, great.
I believe in single dwellings they can identify them, but
sure.
in multi-families you can't identify them.
Okay, all right. I was just thinking 16 tenants, you know,
yeah.
16 tenant, you know, dear tenant or dear tenants, you know, I trying to get everybody on the same page, I think it would have the best effect in my view. But if we're restricted by law and the attorney, so be it. Okay. Mr. Sweeney?
Even putting a letter in the doorway, a door would help notify it besides.
Okay. And water soluble paper. Okay. Any other items, Mr. Walker? Great. Thank you. Appreciate it. Okay. So... direction to town staff, modifications, anything else? No? Okay. Mr. Mayor, anything?
No, just to really have to, the food chain is the owner of the property.
Okay.
I mean, that's the main one.
Okay.
Yeah, you can call it. Okay, thank you.
Great. All right. Everybody comfortable moving on to the next agenda item? Is that sufficient for our needs? Okay, very good.
I can come back in August.
So we have an expectation, Ms. Sipperly, reasonable to see this in August? Is that
sure
a fair expectation? Okay, so when we set our agenda, we can bring that back. Okay, we now move to agenda item number 2, discussion of proposed dog park.
Gee, that's me. I have some handouts for you. Give me a chance to stand up.
Thank you very much.
The dog park has been going on for a few months now. There was a suggestion that a dog park be placed. Well, first of all, look at the first page. And this is what it would look like. In either of the two locations, there's a smaller section for small dogs and a larger square section for larger dogs, and it's about 200 feet by 100 feet total. If you look at the second page of the packet where it says Site A, that is right off the end of Cedar Avenue where the, I guess it was a softball field. It's been turned into something else. But there's a parking lot there, clump of trees, and a kind of a depression. That's one place that was suggested. And at a previous meeting, one of the neighbors came and said he'd be bothered by it there because he thought it would be noisy. And I think that was his major issue. And the other site that was suggested was down off the end of the parking lot by the, I guess it's the Babe Ruth field. Mm-hmm. You'd have to walk a little ways to get to it, but it's off the southwest corner of Southgate. So those were the two ideas, I guess, that were taken to the Parks and Rec Committee at a meeting a month ago or so.
Yeah.
And maybe you can fill us in on what the, we were not aware that a decision was made as far as.
A decision wasn't made, or only two members of the committee showed up. So there wasn't a decision made about the location from the committee.
Mm-hmm. So that's where we sit. The last two pages of the packet are financial, our budget costs for the two different ones. The first one is the Site A, mm-hmm. would include the a drinking fountain, two dog drinking fountains. We could. Apparently, there will be a line extended to the baseball field that this dog park could tie into and have drinking fountains for the dogs, which is a standard accessory, I guess you'd call it, in a standard equipment in most dog parks that I've been to. And then the second one, the difference here between the two, first one would take considerable amount of grading and fill. And then the second one doesn't have the dog drinking fountains in it because it would be so far to run the water line.
Just to clarify, when you say the first one, you mean Site A?
Right.
We'll require extra grading And right. then Site B, we won't be allowed to have water lines there.
Correct.
Okay.
So that's, I don't have an opinion on it either way. I think some of the issues with Site A could be addressed with some shrubbery to hide it from the adjoining neighbor. I have not been to dog parks where there's particular amount of noise.
How much is the additional grading going to cost? Is that in the plan here? Yeah, I see grading.
That was in the
This first budget is for Site A, and the second budget is for Site B?
Right.
Okay.
Our initial grant for the dog park was for $17,000.
Right.
There's another round of grants through the community parks and playground that are open until August 15th. There was discussion that if you chose Site A with the higher budget, that we could submit for the additional funding on this second grant. Because my understanding is once you do the grading, it's gonna have to sit for a good period of time. So we could get the second grant to pay for the remaining part of the budget, if that's the way you choose to go.
Could the second grant pay for extending the water line to Site B? Is that an option for that?
I would have to talk to our Director of Public Works and our water superintendent, but if they said that is something that is possible, we could look into that.
Okay.
But again, it's got to be filed before August 15th.
Okay.
And the shrubbery, I'm sorry, Cliff, go ahead.
No, I didn't see where it said the water on the A. It doesn't show how much the water cost was for the installation of the water.
The water line was already going to be done as part of the Babe Ruth Field. It was a small extension, so we were just going to also include that with the dog park, so there wasn't going to, it wasn't put in as part of the grant since there was other usage for it.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
We might need a lift to get it up, the pumping station, to get it up the hill to the back location. You know, I don't know if the pressure will carry it. I don't know. We'll just have to see. I think I heard that one of the meetings.
So yes, it would, you think?
Well, I know the water goes to the water line goes all the way to the old, the water and sewer goes to where we had the old concession stand, the old caboose was sitting there. So that's where it stops up.
Mm-hmm.
I do know that.
Could you show me where the caboose was on the...
Oh, you don't remember the caboose?
I do not remember the caboose.
The caboose was on the other side of the circle.
Folder on the caboose.
Where you go right through the cul-de-sac.
Is that right here?
Yeah, it's at, over here on the other side of the path.
Okay, so here?
So
yes.
Okay,
great. There's sewer line.
The dog fountains are on both proposals?
Mm. No, they are not on the Site B.
No, they were adding them free.
Yeah, well, it says two dog fountains, $900. Two dog fountains, optional, $900. This does not... So, I'm confused.
Okay. I guess if you did not... It says optional, and then it would be $1,800 for the fountains, but the water line... The cost of the water line is not included in here on either of them, but on Site B, it would be going beyond the baseball field. So it would be an additional cost, and I would have to talk to Dan.
So there is potential to have water on Site B then?
After discussion with, say, Jimmy and Dan to see if it's possible.
Okay.
I mean, if they would have to trench a line back is what they would have to do.
So if we want to spend enough money, I'm sure we could do it. Absolutely. That's the question of how much, though. That's
right.
What we would find out from staff.
The downside that I've heard on Site B was that once you got to the parking lot and parked, then you'd have to walk a distance to get to the dog park, but...
Well, most of I've seen you have to walk, that I have seen the dog park, they have to park and walk too.
And the other point that I just noticed was that if somebody hit a home run, it could hit somebody in the dog park if it was located there.
Yeah, and safety was a concern for that resident about Site A, too. He was afraid that dogs would get loose, that if his kids were in the backyard, mm-hmm. you know, their safety would be compromised.
And the lady.
And the question about dogs.
There was two,
and
yeah.
Runners. That was the other safety concern.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just worried about dogs off the leash in general in the area. So that was
yes.
a concern.
The two residents that I had met with talked to the other neighbors who live along this mountaineer's way,
mm-hmm.
and they do not want the dog park at Site A. That's what my understanding was. They didn't have any problem with the Site B. They said it would be, they'd rather have it at Site B, and they felt it would be safer for back there, but the...
Even though that's closer to a house?
How'd they know about Site B?
Well, it doesn't say that here, though. It says 177 feet versus 164.
The first I
How
saw
about the other?
51 from the shore. Okay.
Is that the one? So that is
so,
Site B.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
One's further. Okay.
You know how far of a walk?
Well, here's the other question, though. I mean, did staff contact the HOA, just curiously, or the... The folks who had come into before, no?
I don't believe so.
Did anybody contact the residents of the community who spoke the first time? Because I thought we'd offered to contact them before we were going to discuss this again.
Well,
I mean, do I remember that incorrectly?
Well, that's the thing okay. about it is that when the subject of the dog park came up,
mm-hmm.
a few of the new members for the Parks Committee
mm-hmm.
live here
mm-hmm.
in this neighborhood. So you have two people that live directly near Site B, and then a neighbor that lives kind of farther away, and then you have the gentleman in the Hack Ryan's house, old house,
okay.
that is saying no, absolutely not.
Okay.
But I haven't heard from any of the other residents that I know of about whether they are for it or against it.
Well, I'm just a little concerned we're even talking about this tonight without having followed through on what we were going to say we're going to do regarding contacting them and saying this is going to come up for discussion. I know we advertise it. I know that. I mean, obviously there's that. But I thought as a courtesy we'd be in touch based on what we had said we would do based on their request. Now, if I'm misremembering that, correct me, but I don't think I'm misremembering that. I mean, I thought we were going to reach out to these folks and say, hey, this is coming up again.
I thought we did that through the Parks Committee. I was there with Commissioner Miller, and people did come from that community.
Sure.
I think they were invited.
Are those the same folks who spoke in the town meeting, though? That's what I don't know. I mean, are those the same committee members?
Yes.
I thought somebody was like the HOA president or something.
Yes,
like that.
I don't know who the HOA president is
that
for that community. Do you?
Mr. T.J. Burns.
Then he's okay. on the committee.
Okay, all right.
He wasn't there at the Parks Committee.
Do you know if he was aware of this meeting tonight? Do you have any idea? No.
Other than it being advertised on the web and all those other places.
Okay.
I mean, I try to keep them.
Sure. No, I know that.
You know, but it feels like we're having the same meeting over and over and over again.
Right.
Like, these are the two locations, and we keep having the same meeting about these two locations.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I don't know.
Well, I thought actually about Site C, no joke intended, sliding what's B further over away from the properties. I mean, there's an open field there. Sliding it over closer toward the right field line, toward
mm-hmm.
the tree line there.
Right.
I mean, I know that would increase.
The concern was that people wouldn't be able to find it, people wouldn't use it, that it was too far off the beaten, it wasn't accessible enough.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. What I thought would be a good idea, but I guess it's to sacrifice space. It won't be as large of a dog park, but to put it over by the behind the antique mall between the baseball field where the play web is and the swing sets.
Mm-hmm.
Take the swings down and use the money in the CIP earmarked for Emmett Gardens to reinstall the web elsewhere and then put the dog park over by the ball fields. But then that takes quite a bit of dog park away. I think that makes it like 75 feet by 100 feet.
Okay.
But that it's takes it thought. Out of the residential area. Right. There's already water at the snack shack there, right. You know, the press box. And, you know, those swings aren't compliant anyway. But, you know, it's going to make it considerably smaller, which
takes away from the value.
Yeah, I think people want a big dog park. But I can't figure any other place that it could go.
This last weekend, I was up at Ithaca, New York, and they have like a 5-acre dog park. And it's like a park inside a park. You have small dogs, big dogs, and they have picnic tables inside of it. And people are sitting around where their dogs are flying around. And
The one at Myrtle Beach was like that. It was huge.
And, why don't you perk on it?
All right. Does anybody have any leaning at this point in time regarding A or B?
There was also discussion about moving it.
Closer
to community gardens and sacrificing the ball field there. But it's my understanding that the Maryland, the club baseball team, was using that field.
Right.
A couple years ago, like they asked for permission to use it, and they were going to make it the mound and make
storm.
It. Yeah. And are they still using that?
Yep. They were there.
Okay. So then that's not an option.
Yeah, they just recut it all back out.
Yeah.
But I did see a couple people in this weekend let their dogs loose within there. So.
Right.
Yeah, well.
Well, you know, and what if we relocate the tennis court? The basketball court.
Ooh, they're expensive.
That would be,
I don't know.
That would be too small, too.
Creative, but no, I know what you're saying. Like, we'd move community garden and those, again, that'd be, community garden's very mobile. I mean, much to its credit.
Yeah.
It's a project on wheels. Okay. So, the field behind us is owned by the county, so that's off.
Yeah, wouldn't that be nice?
The mayor's house. No. Right back at you, Chief. Just saying, you know.
With the Emmitsburg sign.
But right. Emmitsburg sign is your park bench back, yes. They have that in Barnesville. It's kind of quaint.
I make a recommendation to use Site B, and maybe they can apply for the extra money for water installation and maybe a walking path or black or whatever we can get to go to it if we have to move it over around the corner. But this field is, we don't have any 18, 19 year olds playing anymore. This field is the size of Memorial Stadium.
Yep.
So
nobody uses that?
Yes, they do use it. 13 year olds use it and they do not hit the ball over the fence because it is way far back. It's 300 and some feet back. 300. Mm.
The university uses it sometimes, I know. Is that a paid agreement? Just curiously, do we know, Mr. Briggs?
I haven't seen them using it lately.
I've seen, well, they're out now, but I mean, this spring I did. I did see them there.
Good practice.
Taking cuts and such.
Yeah.
Mr. Briggs, do you know if we have an agreement with the Mount where they use that for a fee or?
They come over and use it in the spring. And
yeah, for practice. There. And when they ain't used, nobody's using it.
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
They probably.
So there is some use of it for a field that size. I guess that's what I'm trying to get at. Okay.
But I think we have to put signs up anyways for you put your dogs in here at your own risk because they could be fighting.
I have to go back and watch
everything. And so if you put that in there, put your dogs in here at your own risk, that can cover the baseballs if they come out from the Mount St. Mary's also because they're the ones they see the sign at your own risk, put the dog in there.
Okay. So, Mr. Sweeney, are you making a motion for
Site I make B? A motion to use Site B. And for Kathy and them to submit to the Maryland for our
Community Parks and Playground.
Yeah, for the grant to extend the water line from the old where it stops at here in front of the ball field. It stops in front of the ball field They would have to trench it around and a 1-inch line of plastic line to bring over for the to put the two the fire hydrant things in, which will be the underground like they have it. We have it at the pavilion already. That's what we're going for, the water.
Simplify the motion. We'll put that in the discussion. Just a thought.
Because she needs to get in for Kathy to apply for the grant money to.
Understood.
Mm-hmm. And that includes covering a path to goes to it.
Correct.
It okay, might not be that long, but we have a path there already. We just extended over.
So the motion's been made to identify Site B as the dog park site with direction for town to apply to the grant source to extend the water line and to extend the walking path, an access path?
Yes, is that over to it.
Does that characterize it correctly?
Yes.
Okay.
Wouldn't be much.
Is there a second for the motion?
I'll second the motion.
Okay, the motion's been made by Commissioner Sweeney. It's been seconded by Commissioner Blanchard. Is there any further discussion?
And Mr. Bryson and the other lady, I forget her name, they were at the Parks and Recreation Committee meeting.
Canales.
And they were on board 100% with Site B.
No.
No.
Not all of them.
Mr. Bryson was not.
Absolutely. Wow.
Site B.
Mr. Bryson's not on board with a dog park in general. Yeah. In this area.
I have a map of the.
Okay.
I don't know what the lady's name is. I think she's a soccer coach. Or
yeah.
Something.
She's a professor.
She said she talked to
her. I don't know who she said. She thought she didn't mention names. She just said she talked to the neighbors. And they didn't have a problem with B when she
McDonald's,
went out.
McDonald's, yeah. We were thinking here or.
I showed her where, you know, it might be. Or Site B was.
Might blocks.
Might
yeah,
be.
That.
When was this?
Thing they were thinking back up here.
After the meeting we had with
I can
here.
Distract you from
okay.
looking at the light.
Okay.
They were here at a meeting.
But we're
yes, I remember. I just wanted
here.
To know when.
Okay. Is there any further discussion? Gentlemen, hold on for a second. Is there any further discussion related to this? Gentlemen.
Yep.
No? Mr. Briggs, nothing? Okay. All right. Ladies, gentlemen. Mr. Ritz, yes, sir.
My last comment will
sure.
just be, I feel that if we pass this evening, I feel confident that within sometime in the near future, this is going to be brought up. Hey, board, why did you do this? That's all.
Okay. No, I agree with you. I was hoping we'd have representation from the neighborhood here based on
yeah.
what we discussed. And I understand the committee work has been done. I understand the private conversation, but I was hoping for representation in the meeting. Okay, so that having been said, any further discussion? Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
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 All against, please say nay.
Nay.
Nay. Okay, so the motion fails 2-3 in favor, Commissioner Sweeney, Commissioner Blanchard, against Commissioner Ritz, Commissioner Mellor, Commissioner O'Donnell. I would like to see this come back.
I would too.
And
yes.
If I really want the neighborhood here, if we can do that, just a more direct outreach. I would be much more comfortable assigning this long-term use if we've heard from the community more directly. So, okay. So there we go.
Excuse me, but I think we would also have an obligation to somehow notify more than just this neighborhood who may be against it, but there may be people on Main Street who, you know.
No, I understand that, but what occurred in that meeting, I had felt that we had extended an offer to inform them directly, and I don't feel that we had done that to my satisfaction.
I wasn't working on
sure, no, and I understand that, and I agree with you. I mean, this is for the community. I fully agree with you on that issue. And that's why I feel that we should bring it back as opposed to, you know, shelf it and let it gather dust.
Yeah, and there's the other side of the coin, too. There might be an overwhelming support for it, you know, come
correct.
To a public meeting. You
it's
know,
going to have to come back at the next meeting if you want to be able to apply for any additional
that
funding.
August grant. That and that, I have no issue with that. I have no issue
is there
with
a way, on at least on the, if we're going to propose this, the sites, like, to actually have an attachment with the showing?
In the packet? You mean? Is that what you're...
For public knowledge, yes. if we post it on the website.
If it's in the packet, it'll be posted with the agenda, which happens the Thursday before the meeting.
Okay. But if it just says discussion of dog park, Is there any way we can add to that? You know, have a like an attachment to it, a visual?
Well, yes. Okay. Yes.
Well, I wouldn't characterize this as a discussion. I mean, we voted on it. So moving forward, again, it would not be a discussion item just for conversation.
It would be
an action item
approval.
To be voted upon. Yeah. Right. Okay. For consideration. Okay.
Right. And I did receive an email from a lady who was all for it. She was very excited about it.
Great. Okay. And I honestly think we will hear that from the community. But at the same time, I think we extended that opportunity. We extended that offer, and I don't know that we followed through on it yet, and I hope that we will. So
just one more thing, Chris. Yes, sir. Just that a member of the Parks Committee is the HOA president for that community, and he was invited to the last meeting, and other people from that neighborhood came, so the word got out somehow.
Sure.
It wasn't like it just... anything wasn't done, but
I know, I understand that. I don't think we're trying to be sneaky in any way. I don't think there's anything shadowy about this, but that offer is important to me. If we extend it, I really think that should be followed up on.
Sure.
So
okay,
thank you, sir. Any other comments before we move forward? No? Okay, moving forward. All right, we now go to agenda item number 4, recommended hiring of Matthew Desmond for the position of lead sewer water operator.
Okay. As you know, we had an open position at the wastewater treatment plant for a lead sewer water operator, and we ran an ad. It is a very particular position with qualifications that not a lot of people have. We got a few applications. And in those applications, only one person had some of the qualifications that we were looking for, and that was Matthew Desmond. We conducted an interview, myself, Mr. Haller, and Mr. Fissel, and the mayor, sorry. And then Mr. Fissel ended up taking him on a tour and interacting with him. This gentleman, he currently works for the wastewater treatment plant in Frederick. He runs a crew there, so he is a supervisor, so he'd be able to manage the two operators we currently have. He is in the possession of a Class 5A wastewater license, which at this time our staff does not have yet since the plant is brand new. They're currently working on it. He's got master plumber training or license, and he's already got a CDL. He's got all the licenses that we require at this time, with the exception of the water one, which he's already intended to get within 6 months. He is a Marine Reserves, and what else we got here? He used to work for the wastewater treatment plant in Westminster. He currently works on his own time at, I believe, the one in?
Frederick City?
No, Union Bridge.
Okay, right.
So we've highly recommend him. Like I said, Mr. Haller sat on the interview. He has a lot more expertise involved with the wastewater treatment plant. He knew what we should be looking for. He highly recommends Mr. Desmond. Mr. Fissel was very happy with him. Myself and the mayor were pleased. We would like your vote to hire him at a grade 9, step 3. I think that he will be very valuable to our team, and with Mr. Fissel looking to retire in the next 5 years, Mr. Desmond may be able to fill those shoes without having to go look outside.
Copy.
I think he's a good investment.
He was on active duty with the Marine Corps for 6 years.
Very good.
And okay. I was in the reserves.
Okay.
And,
okay. Any questions for staff related to this recommendation? No. One thing related to the hiring consideration at this time, you mentioned that there's a 6 month contingency related to a license. Wait,
what we were looking for, the water license, because we do operate the water plant and the wastewater treatment plant. So we were looking for either or when we advertised the position, because okay. If we asked for both, we probably would have never found anybody.
Right.
He currently possesses the Class 5A wastewater, which is the most difficult license to obtain.
Okay.
He is very interested in getting his water license, which okay. We're hoping that he will get within 6 to 8 months.
Okay. Do we want any contingency? That's what I was asking. That's what
okay.
I'm trying to get. I'm sorry. Do we want to build in a contingency, you know, grade 9, step 2 until he earns that license and then make him step 3? Is there any
Well,
values?
We do have built in already a contingency upon successful completion of the 6 months.
Okay.
To move him from grade 9 to step 5.
Okay.
So we did start him at the step 3.
Okay.
With the 6 month introductory period, get your license, make sure it's working for both of us,
right.
And then offering the grade 9 step 5.
Very good. So we're in the engagement phase, perhaps. Okay.
Correct.
All right. Any other questions for staff? Okay. Is there a motion related to this recommendation by town staff, by the town manager?
I'll make a motion to support the recommended hiring of Matthew Desmond for the position of lead sewer water operator.
Very good. Thank you, sir. Is there a second for this motion?
I second.
Okay. The motion has been made by Commissioner Blanchard and seconded by Commissioner Mellett. Commissioner Meller.
Very funny.
Can you add in the motion that he's hired at a grade 9, step 3, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. Recommend hiring of Matthew Desmond for the position of lead sewer water operator at the position of step 9?
Grade 9, step 3.
Grade 9, step 3.
Okay, very good. Calling to vote. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone against? No. The motion carries 5-0. Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you for your due diligence there. Okay, so at this time we have a completed agenda. We now turn to setting the agenda for our August 1st town meeting. Our hope is to see the discussion concerning the sidewalk maintenance piece. Okay, or do we want to make that a discussion item or potentially an action item? Any consideration there?
Right, you can always put it as an action item, and if you decide you don't want to vote,
correct.
It won't
okay.
limit you.
All right,
it is
so
an action item.
Okay, therefore, we do so. All right, the second item would be the proposed dog park. Okay, and I would ask the staff to please contact the committee member who is the president of the HOA.
I'll reach out to them as well.
As well, great, okay. Terrific, thank you. Mm-hmm. And beyond that, is there anything that the staff or the mayor wants to bring forward
agenda items? I'm sorry. We'll have the resolution for the community legacy grant related to the square.
Which could be administrative.
We could make that administrative business. And then I had two. Related to the credit card swipe machine that we were discussing, we will have to charge a fee for the credit card usage. That would have to be a policy approved by the board. So we would like to bring that to you in August so we can have it up and running by the middle of August.
Okay. Mr. Mayor?
That also we have to have the salary chart approved.
Yes.
Go ahead, Kathy. You have the proper way of saying that.
In relationship with the budget, when you pass the budget, we do an ordinance. What goes hand in hand with that is an ordinance to approve the salary chart, which was part of your budget. That was not presented at the time, so we'll have to bring that to you for approval.
Okay. All right. Anybody else have any agenda items?
Potentially.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
After our July 19th Citizen Advisory Committee meeting, if we discuss the nuisance ordinance
okay.
more and we have enough members in attendance, might have something to present.
Okay.
And maybe something else stemming from that meeting. I'm not sure at this time. However, I will certainly let Ms. Willits know.
Sure. Okay. Do you want that as a discussion item or an action item with the fallback of discussion? I mean, do you think they're going to come forward with language?
Let's make it an action item.
I think we still have to go to the attorney with it, though, unless it's already been vetted. Isn't that right? I mean, you come back with a recommendation based on the language. We review it, then it goes to the attorney.
Oh, well, I mean, it could be recommendations. It's merely recommendation.
Okay.
It wouldn't be yes. I see what you're saying. No, it wouldn't be an actual.
Commissioner, is that admin?
No,
I think. Do you want to do this as administrative business?
Start there.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. So we'll put that on the administrative business agenda, the discussion or the nuisance ordinance input from the Citizens Advisory Committee.
Yeah.
Is that okay to carry?
Yeah.
That way?
Yeah. I think that's great.
Okay.
Potentially have it finalized to then present to town staff to present to the town attorney.
Okay, yeah. Sure. That works. Mr. Sweeney.
Do we have anything on planning and zoning that might need brought up after our meeting?
No. We have something that the institutional zone accessory structures thing, I got some input back from the town attorney that I will present to the Planning Commission on the meeting at the end of July, which is so I'm looking at the September meeting. Okay. For bringing that back, because that's one that has to be advertised as right. A public hearing.
I just wanted to make sure while we had a
we won't have a complete document to advertise before the end of the July. So
okay,
I do have another thing.
Sure, Mr. Sweeney.
Elections are coming up. Do you have to advertise for election judges and stuff like that?
We've already started. We already got contacted by one, and we're checking on the other three. Looking for an alternate.
Okay, and pool party ad, of course. So, okay. Any other agenda items? All right. Is there a motion to accept the agenda items as presented?
Make a motion to accept the agenda items as written.
Is there a second for the motion?
I'll second.
Okay. Any further discussion of the agenda items and administrative business items? Hearing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries 5-0. Very good. Okay. Any final comments before we adjourn before our closed session?
No.
Okay. Very good. So the meeting. Let's get this right. Okay. The meeting adjourns at 9:41 p.m. This is our July 5th, 2016 town meeting.